Good morning. Welcome to Harvest. We have another amazing opportunity to worship and serve our Lord this morning, so we're going to put Him in focus, and I would encourage you guys to stand up and just really appreciate that we have the opportunity to get to do so openly and freely. It's awesome that we get to do so. So would you please stand, and we'll begin our worship set.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for you. All that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. All that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
All right, would you take a minute and greet your neighbor?
Good morning. Hey, don't I sound good? From last week, I sound much, much better. Last week, I thought I was going to see the Lord early because it was, like, not good. Want to thank everybody for coming out for the fiesta. I'm not sure all the numbers yet, but every little bit we got is going to go to good use, so thank you. We are still taking donations, and we also have begun our kind of a, what do you call it, creating a promise? Offering promise, a pledge. I'm sorry, that's what it is. Sorry, my brain's not working right now yet. So we are starting that, and so just so you know, you can see Paul, which he's not here today, or myself, or Grady, or somebody, or Tonda, to try and get your funds wherever you want them to go. All right, Dave, you ready? Maybe I'm not ready. Where would we be without our phones? Okay. What was the first one, Dave? Is it youth group? Okay, all right. So this is our welcome back to church, his kids this Wednesday. Oh, my gosh. It is a luau. We are going to have things set up in the back. It is a family night. We have started. That's our kickoff. Please come and join us. We're going to have kind of luau food buffet. It is a great night. Normally, we start with a meal, and then a devotional. We also do a craft. And this one, we're going to kind of just go over what our year is going to look like, and I really would love to see new families there. I talked to a couple of families, and some of them can't make it this week, but that doesn't mean I don't want you. I mean, I want you to come every week you can. So please come join us 6 o'clock on Wednesday, and look forward to having a fun time. All right, next one, Children's Church. Next Sunday, yes, begins back here. Amanda is in charge of that. We are still looking for teachers and those who want to help do our lessons, so please see her, and we'll get you hooked up. Back to church Sunday. All right. Now, there is a national campaign that happens usually the 15th or so of every September every year. I will not be here this week or next that weekend, so we are going to push it to the 22nd. We're going to have a harvest welcome back to church. It'll be with a fellowship in the morning, and so if any of you know, our fellowships are usually awesome. Lots of food, lots of laughter, lots of fellowship. So I hope to see you there at 9:30 on that Sunday. Come back to church. Bring a friend. Bring someone that you've talked to or are on your heart to come to church. What better place to be on Sunday? And then flags. We are signed up for Kiwanis flags. We have 3 more days to do. Is that right, Terrace? Beginning tomorrow, and then, of course, September 11th, and then November 11th, which is Veterans Day. We do have a sign-up sheet. I do understand that some of you don't have the internet as far as learning how to sign this up, so this is what's been filled out for tomorrow. We have a spot open in the morning at 5:30 in the morning, and then we have 2 spots open at 5:30 in the evening. And then next week, we'll have the 9/11 one up for those flaggers who want to do that. And believe me, this is a great project here in Goodland, in Sherman County. It's a great testament to our faith and everything else, and displaying our flag is an awesome thing. So hope you would take part in that. And I believe that's it. Sorry about all that rambling.
Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 9, verse 7 to 10. The Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. He will judge the world in righteousness. He will govern the people with justice. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Those who know your name will trust in you. For you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Let's pray. Glorious Father, we worship your name. We come before you with thanksgiving, praise, and honor this morning. Father, let our praises come to you. Receive our sacrifices of praise, Father, they are from our heart. As we worship this morning, may your name be lifted high. Thank you, in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, would you please stand? We'll continue with the worship set.
Pharisee, you came for hypocrites, even one like me. You carry sin and shame, the guilt of every man, the weight of all I've done, nailed into your hand.
God, I fall down to my knees with a hammer.
You look at me, arms open, forgiven, forgiven. Child, there is freedom from all of it. Say goodbye to every sin, you are forgiven. I hadn't done. I've seen things I wish I hadn't seen. Just the thought of your amazing grace, and I cry, Jesus, forgive me. God, I fall down to my knees with a hammer in my hand. You look at me, arms open, forgiven, forgiven. Child, there is freedom from all of it. Say goodbye to every sin, you are forgiven. Six feet under, I could have been lost forever. I should have been in that fire, but now there's fire inside of me. Here I am, a dead man walking, no grave gonna hold God's people. All the weight of all our evil lifted away, forever free. Who could believe, who could believe?
Forgiveness.
was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah! Christ is risen. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He
blessing over the offering. Please join me. Heavenly Father, thank you for the many blessings. Thank you for this day. We ask you to bless this offering, multiply it, and give us the wisdom to push it forward, to use it for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good. Okay. I've been given the go ahead. Good morning, everyone. I am very honored today to speak to us about prayer. It is a privilege for me. Pastor Brian is out of town this weekend. The whole family is getting together this weekend. At the lake house in Nebraska. All the kids are in town. Caleb and Suji and their two daughters flew from Florida. And Kaylan and Odu from Denver, they joined them. And they have Becky and Tim and the whole extended family. So they're having a good time, but it's also giving me an opportunity to share with you what I'm really passionate about. It's about talking about prayer. I want to talk about 7 reasons why you should pray. I know we can come out with a lot of reasons, but I wanted to narrow it down to seven. When I did this, narrow it down to seven so I can focus on each of the point one day of the week. So you can come out with your own. I'm sure somebody can come out with 20. I'm sure somebody can come out with 11. But that was my reason. When it comes to prayer, the Lord has commanded us to pray. Okay. The number one reason why you should pray is that prayer stops you from entering into temptation. Without prayer, we fall into all kinds of temptations. So prayer stops you from entering into temptation. From Pastor Brian's message last week, we learned that no one is immune to temptation. Jesus was tempted by the devil. We heard about the story of Joseph. He was tempted by Potiphar's wife. So it's not a matter of if, it's when we'll be tempted. Temptation abound. We face daily temptations. In 1 Peter 5:8, Peter urged believers to stay alert and be vigilant and watch for spiritual attacks from the enemy. And these spiritual attacks normally come in the name of temptation. It said, be sober-minded, be watchful. Put it another way, pray. Your adversary, the devil, prowls like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Temptations are traps that are set up by the enemy to lure believers to sin, and in the process, as we learned last week, destroy families. The Bible in Ephesians 6:12 says that we are in a spiritual battle. Say, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of the dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Many of us get burned out fighting these battles because sometimes we use the wrong method, we fight with our wrong weapons. Sometimes we fight the wrong battles. We get burned out fighting these spiritual battles. The Bible commands us to fight these battles with prayer. Ephesians 6:18 says, we should pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, talking about temptations and spiritual battles, be alert and always keep on praying for the Lord's people. It's interesting that the disciples asked Jesus to teach them how to pray. In the Lord's Prayer, he told them, pray that you don't fall into temptation. So, as believers, we have to be serious about this. It is serious. That's what Jesus talked about it. That's why it's in the Lord's Prayer, to pray not to fall into temptations. Many believers that I know do not consistently pray this. And I think we need to recognize that temptations are a daily thing, and we have to, like in the Lord's Prayer, we have to pray daily not to fall or enter into these temptations. Think about the story in Luke 22. And in the story, Jesus specifically prayed for Peter to remain strong in the faith during temptation. I find it very interesting that Jesus didn't pray for the temptation to be taken away. He didn't pray that Peter would have an easy way out. He just said, Peter, I pray for you. I prayed for you. When we have family members, we have friends who are going through difficult times, and we know that the enemy has had a foothold in their life. Pray for them. I also find it very interesting that in the scripture, Jesus told Peter specifically that, Peter, I am praying for you. I prayed for you. What that tells me is if somebody is going through temptation, you're praying for them, let them know that you're praying for them. Your prayers and encouragement will help them overcome. So, prayer stops us from falling into temptation. Number two, your prayers are not only for the present. You can pray into the future. This is what makes prayer so powerful. Your prayers can impact generations long after you are gone. Let's say God sent you an angel and said, maybe, Grady, I want you to ask me something specific in prayer. I will answer that prayer for you. But this is the caveat. I will answer that prayer 100 years after your death. What will you pray for? I know you will not be praying for a house. I know we will not be praying for finances. What will you pray for? In John 17:20, Jesus prayed for future believers. Those who will come to believe in him. Those yet unborn, 2,000 years, Jesus prayed. You are sitting here because Jesus prayed for you and made a way for you. In John 17, he said, my prayer is not for them alone. I also pray for those who will believe in me through their message. So our prayers will live long after we are gone. Grandma Sue, the prayers that you pray for your grandkids will live long after you are gone. That's what makes prayer so powerful. When we think about leaving a legacy, we need to think about leaving a legacy of many prayed prayers. We can leave our kids and grandkids inheritance, but also leave them a legacy, an inheritance of many, many prayed prayers, because those prayers will be even effective after you are long gone. One of the things I really love about America's first president, George Washington, is that he was a man of prayer. And in his farewell address, he prayed for the future of America, that this nation will continue to be one nation under God and pray many blessings. That is a legacy. So your prayers are not only for the present. They are for the future too. Number three, prayer indeed has the power to change circumstances, situations, and transform people. As a pharmacist, one of my favorite prayers, I like to pray as I'm in a pharmacy. I see these couples, young couples, sometimes they come and pick up one medication after another, trying to conceive, trying to have a baby. They go for one treatment after another, and I see that they are frustrated. And normally, when I have the opportunity, when I go to the window, I ask them without going through too much privacy, just say, can you share your frustration with me? I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. I don't say, bow down your heads, let's pray. I don't say, close your eyes. I just say, quick prayer, Lord, heal her womb. And at your appointed time, let her have a baby. Sometimes, and I encourage them to pray. I tell them I'm going to be praying for them, and I do. Sometimes I don't see them again. Once in a while, somebody stop by and say, hey, Titus, God answers our prayer. I'm having a baby. I know it's a big thing for them, but I know it's even bigger for me because I've asked the Lord many times, Lord, why will you have me in Goodland, this place? Sometimes just handing out pills. Some of those pills that I hand out, sometimes I don't even know if they are helpful. The Lord said, Titus, just, you know, have me somewhere, like in a mission field where I can be planting churches and doing all kinds of things for the kingdom. Said, well, this is a mission field. Just look around. The harvest is plentiful. Pray that the Lord will open your eyes to your surrounding every day, because whatever the Lord calls us, wherever the Lord calls us, He's called us for a specific reason. And sometimes it is very difficult to find that reason. But every day when we pray, we can stay in the will of God. In Acts 16, Paul and Silas were in prison. They were put in for sharing the gospel. What Paul and Silas did was they prayed and sang hymns. The Bible says that while they prayed and sang hymns, a miracle happened, an earthquake shook the foundations of the prison, leading to their freedom. Their prayer changed their circumstances and the lives of the jailer and his entire family who came to believe in Christ. We never know how God will answer our prayers. We don't know for sure. But we can expect that He will get us involved in His plan. Number four, prayer indeed changes our, deepens our relationship with God and draws us closer to His presence. The story of Peter, We all know that story when Peter was walking on water. And then he began to sink. There are a lot of commentaries on that. But the issue with Peter wasn't that he wasn't aware of the storm. He was aware of the storm. But his issue was, I feel like he got distracted by the storm. And we can have a lot going on, a lot of storm around us. And we can get distracted if we take our focus off the message of the cross. If we take our focus off Jesus, we'll begin to sing. But the good news is, even when we sing, the Lord always have a way. I don't watch a lot of movie, but we was watching a series of the Chosen. And in this particular one, they were talking about this particular scripture. Jesus reach out to stretch a hand to Peter. That's what he does for us. In the storms, he stretches his hand. It's always there. Prayer keep our focus on God. It deepens our relationship with God and draws us to his presence. Number five, prayer keeps us in the will of God and makes us bold. Yes, prayer makes us bold. The Apostle Paul frequently asks believers to pray for him. In Ephesians 6, 19 to 20, he asks believers to pray for him to be bold so that he could share the gospel. He said, pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I am ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly, as I should. I don't know the many times, my friends, that I have an opportunity to share the gospel with someone that I can't count the many times that I've chickened out. Just couldn't cross that chicken line. Sharing the gospel is difficult, but we are called to share the gospel. The Apostle Paul understood this. He asked believers, pray for me so that I will be bold, so I can go and share the gospel. What about you and I? Shouldn't we be praying for each other so that we can be bold and go out and share the gospel? Shouldn't we be praying for ourselves that you'll be bold and fearlessly share the gospel? So prayer makes us bold that we can share the gospel. It's always a day of regret for me when I know someone that I've been planning to connect with and reach out to and maybe share gospel, and I hear that they pass away. Prayer will make us bolder so we can share the gospel. Number six, prayer invites God into our personal situation. When we pray, we release control of our situation to God. We ask God to take control. So in every situation, you have a choice. We have a choice to release control to God, or we have a choice to try to do it on our own. One of my favorite verses, Philippians 4, 6 to 7. He said, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything with prayer and thanksgiving, give your request to God. The peace of God, who transcends all understanding, shall guard your hearts and minds. That's what prayer does. We release control to God, and He takes care of it. He will help us walk through our situation. Sometimes we don't know how we're going to do it, but release it to God. And He said, the peace of God, which surpasses every understanding, shall guard your mind. Number 7, this is my favorite. God answers prayer. But Satan knows this so much. He knows he cannot stop God from answering your prayer. He knows that. It's a fact. You also know that he can stop you from praying. So since he cannot stop God from answering your prayer, what he will do is to stop you from praying. It's very interesting, like, in my personal life, you know, anytime we have disagreement, like in marriage, the first thing the enemy attacks is time together. Why is that? And in many situations, the enemy attacks your ability to pray. Sometimes we can get temporal successes and say, hey, you've been promoted to a bigger job, more responsibilities. Now you are going from A, B, C, D. What was used supposed to be a blessing now is becomes an impediment for you to kneel and pray. The thing is, the enemy doesn't care what the reason. As long as you stop praying, it's okay with that, because he cannot stop God from answering your prayers, but he can stop you. Many of our churches today have become prayerless. And we know that a prayerless church quickly becomes very religious. And that's why we are seeing many of the things that are going on in churches across the world and in our own churches across America, because we're not praying. Churches have become religious. God answers prayer. I want to give you some practical talk about there are a lot of ways that you can pray. But I want to talk about some practical ways you can pray. Janice talked about tacos. This is a disclaimer. I don't like tacos. Okay? I don't like tacos. But I like to pray tacos. Okay? I like to pray tacos. You know, Pastor Brian talked about acts. You know, there are various mnemonics. And there's, but to grow in prayer, you need a backbone to grow in, to start. You have to start from somewhere. So tacos, I'm sure this is easy to remember for most people, for those who like tacos. Thanksgiving, adoration, confession, praying for others, and then praying for yourself. Okay. Let's talk about thanksgiving. Psalm 104-5 says, enter into his gate with thanksgiving, and into his court with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Psalm 9, verse 1 to 2 says, I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. Thanksgiving is an act of faith. Okay. We are called to be thankful regardless if we feel it or not. It's not a feeling. Okay. It's an act of faith. So we have to give thanks. We have to give thanks. Thanks, we have to pray in thanksgiving. In the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, you think about it, when Jesus got the five loaves and the fishes, Jesus didn't pray that, hey, Lord, multiply this. Jesus didn't pray that. Jesus, the Bible says, he simply looked into heaven and gave thanks. You get more when you give thanks. Miracles happen when we give thanks. Adoration. Adoration is focused on the attributes of God, who God is. The I am God. It's focused on his greatness. Think about Hannah's prayer when the prophet Samuel was born. He said, there is none holy like you, Lord. There is none beside you. There is no God like our God. Prayer of adoration. When the angel Gabriel announced to Mary that she was going to give birth to the Messiah, she burst into a song of adoration. He said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he that is mighty has done great things for me. She was focusing on the magnificence of God. This is where sometimes, if you like to sing, this is a good place to sing. You can sing prayers of adoration and prayers of thanksgiving. Sometimes I kind of go into a little place so the kids will say, Dad, what are you singing? Yeah. So, prayer of adoration. Confession. Next one, focusing on confession. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. David prayed a lot of these prayers. Psalm 51, verse 1 to 2. It says, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquities, and cleanse me from my sin. In verse 10, 12, he says, create in me, O God, a pure heart, and renew the steadfast spirit within me. And his prayers focusing on confession and asking God to forgive you your shortcoming is really important. Praying for others. This can be really, really long list. And you can spend a lot of time here. If you have children and grandchildren, this is, you can pray for them. When I pray for my children and the children that I know that in my life, pray for them that they'll know Jesus. Like, pray that God will help my kids to build a relationship with you. Pray that they'll recognize that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the light. Pray that you'll have the fruit of the Holy Spirit. You will experience those fruits: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Pray that you see those in your kids. Pray for true repentance. God, help my kids to see sin for what it is. Something that pulled them away from God, and help them to turn to you when they go wrong. Grant them repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth. Pray for their self-esteem. God, show my child that they are loved. In this world, the kids need to know that, and pray for that they are worth because they were created by you. Help them to realize they are God's masterpiece. Pray that they will have perseverance. God, help my child not to give up when things get difficult, but turn to your strength. Help them to grow through challenges they face. And then that the testing of their faith will produce perseverance in them. Pray that they will have self-control. God, help my child to exercise self-control in the world that urges instant gratification. And when they feel they attempted to do what is wrong, may you give them a way out. Pray that they will work hard. We need children to work hard. So you got to pray for them. God, help my child to recognize the value of good work and hard work. Give them the excitement about work as they recognize you and make a difference in the kingdom. Teach them that whatever they do, they will do it with all their heart as if they are working for the Lord. Pray that they will know their purpose. This is a very important one. Pray that your kids and grandchildren will know their purpose. You can say, God, help my child to embrace your purpose and give them discernment for what they are created for. You can pray a lot of these prayers. Pray for their salvation. For my child to recognize the need for salvation and seek freedom from sin. So, a lot. You can pray for your children. Then under this, you're married, pray for your wife and husband. Okay, guys, this is where we need to be careful. Okay. Don't pray that God should change your wife. No. I prayed that before, it didn't work. I read a book a few years ago by Stormy Omartian. I'm sure I pronounced that wrong. It changed my perspective on how I pray for my wife. Okay. So pray that you have strong faith and grow spiritually. and pray that your wife will spend more time in the Word of God and in prayer. Pray that she'll have peace. Pray that her children will honor her. And pray for her health. Many things. For your husband, pray that God will bless the work of his hands. Pray for your husband to trust God with all his burdens. And also pray that your husband will have godly friends who encourage him. Guys, we don't normally volunteer information. So we need really good friends who can be by our side and once in a while just speak into our life. So pray that your husband will have a friend like that. Pray that your husband will think about the as it said in Philippians 4:8, things that are true. It's very important that he will seek things that are noble, things that are right, and pray for purity of heart, things that are lovely, and will seek things that are praiseworthy for your family as he leads. So those are some of the prayers you can pray for your husband. Then pray for your friends, family, church. Pray for your country and the leaders. You are commanded to do that. Pray for missionaries, pastors. Pray for salvation. Pray for our community. So this is where you can, as you expand on this, you can add more and more. Okay. And then pray for self. I like this praying tacos because I used to normally jump in and pray for myself first. But now I'm last, according to, you don't have to go on this this order, but I like that I can pray for others before I pray for myself, because I just used to me, and just praying for myself because I just feel like I have so many things, and by the time I gotta go, time is up, gotta go. So I really like that self is last. Okay, pray for courage. God, give me courage when I face scary situation. May I be brave when the things that I need to stand up for, to stand up for the right things. Help me to be strong and courageous. This is a prayer that was prayed in Joshua 1:10. Pray for the fear of God. Pray that you fear God. Pray for endurance. The Christian walk is not a sprint. It's a marathon. Pray that you have endurance. Pray that you have the power not to quit. It's a long journey. You're going to be praying for yourself. Have endurance. Pray for love. In Philippians 1:9 talks about that love abound even more and more in our midst. Pray that your love for the things of God will increase and abound even more in your life. King David prayed in Psalm 27:4, talk about wanting focus. So one thing that I desire, that I seek, that I will dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Pray that you have that same focus. Pray for speech. Okay, this is where a lot of us get into trouble. Set a guard over my mouth, Lord. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you. We need to pray that we will not sin with our tongue. Pray for yourself. So, that's tacos. Can take you hours, 30 minutes, 15 minutes, whatever you want to get out of it. So today, I want to really encourage you. As believers, we are commanded to pray. Seven reasons why you should be praying is that prayer stops you from giving into temptation. The prayers are not only for the present. The future. The prayer has the power to change someone's life, circumstances. Your prayer will transform people. Prayer deepens our relationship with God and draws us closer as we walk in this life. Prayer makes us bold, keep us in the will of God. Prayer invites God into our personal situation so we can have peace because we are giving all to Him. God answers prayer. That should be an encouragement to you. The Bible went as far as saying in James that you do not have because he didn't pray. God will not answer the prayers that he didn't pray. Yeah. He didn't have because he didn't ask. Okay. Let us pray. Father, thank you for your words. Thank you for loving us. Thank you that you are a God who is faithful. Thank you for your faithfulness. In Jesus' name. Amen.